You mentioned communications. For leaders, 80% of their working hours they spend on communications. Mm-hmm. And communicating and being a charismatic conversationalist, you need to have some people skills. Mm-hmm. You need to master people skills. And here we come to etiquette,
yes,
which, you know, is my
area.
Passion and my, yes, area of professional interest. Because etiquette is about social skills. It's about how to interact with others, how to be successful in interacting. And I guess it is important in business, because even if you are speaking about negotiation process, to prepare for negotiation, you need some pre-meeting, and this pre-meeting could be very nicely organized over lunch, and to get more connected personally on a personal level with, yes, your potential clients or partners. And here you need to be confident.
Yes.
And what helps you to be confident? Of course, knowing how to behave. So the, yes, rules of behavior, which is etiquette. So etiquette is a very good tool to be applied in professional and personal life. Have you been in the situation when etiquette came in handy for you? Do you think it could be handy and important?
Yes, absolutely. It is important, especially when, as I said before, I work with people from different cultures. I've traveled all over the world, and you need how to behave. One of the maybe the most striking example for me was the first time I went to India.
Oh, good.
I went to India to set up a team over there, and you had to make sure you know how to first deal with people, basically how to dress. That is very important. That's a mistake. Even though I did do my research at the beginning, it was not enough.
Oh, yes.
So I was dressed with my, let's say, Western clothes, because everybody told me, yes, women over there, they dress like here in Europe. And I arrived there and it was not fully true. So over there, I ended up going to buy some Indian clothes to fit better with the culture. But it was really appreciated, and people were like, wow, she made an effort to be dressed like that. So I think it is very important to respect etiquette, whether you, as you say, you're going for lunch or dinner with a potential client or with your stakeholders or whatever, but also you show interest in how to deal with people, that you respect their manners, their cultures, and that you stay respectful at all time.
Mm,
yes.
Yeah. Yeah, and speaking about communication skills again, they say that a good conversationalist is the person who can listen first. Mm-hmm. And the ratio of listening to speaking could be 2-to-1. In our business etiquette programs at Luxembourg School of Contemporary Etiquette, you are the trainer who deliver a communication skills workshop.
Yes.
Could you give a few tips, like 2 or 3 tips, of how to be a good listener and a good communicator?
Yes. So as you said, it's correct. Great communicators are actually great listeners. And if you don't remember the ratio, it's very easy. We have 2 ears, 2 eyes,
exactly,
and 1 mouth.
Wow,
there is
so
for
right.
one reason. It's so simple, but yes, it is true. So a great communicator listens more than he or she speaks. And how do you do that? Well, first you ask questions. You again start with your audience, as I said a few minutes ago. Observe your audience, listen, and listen to what is said and also what is not said. That is very important. If you see that your audience is not interested or looks bored or looks lost, maybe you used some words or expression that they didn't understand, then pause and ask a question. Did you understand? Shall I paraphrase? So that again, people have the opportunity to really go back into your message and understand what you were saying.
Mm.
So all of this is very important. So to your point, the tips is again, making sure you stop, you pause, you observe, and you listen. These are key when you want to communicate something. The next things are obviously to speak clearly and precisely, to not assume that what you know is what is obvious for you may not be obvious for someone else. Again, when you deal with people from different countries or cultures, they may not know certain expressions, they may not know the reference you're making, maybe you're making a reference about a series or a movies and people may not have seen it or it's not something that they are familiar with. So you really should never assume that what you know, what is obvious for you, is obvious for others. So again, pause, observe and listen.
Very interesting. Some people say that it's absolutely possible to learn communication skills. Mm-hmm. And those who believe that, they are more successful. And those who think that these are like fixed personal traits, they would probably not succeed in the end of the day. Do you think that the same could be applied for public speaking? Because I know that to be successful in public speaking is a crucial skill which leaders should possess.
Yes.
But for many people, it's not so easy to be a public speaker. Do you think that the same pattern, like through learning, you could gain a skill, obtain this skill, could apply to public speaking?
Absolutely. And I know that because I was member of Toastmasters. For those of you who may not know this organization, it's a non-profit organization who helps you improve your leadership and public speaking skills. And I've seen people in my club where I am who were scared of talking the first time to present themselves. They were shaking, they were very afraid, they were hesitating, they were stumbling. It's the first time is always very scary, but then after, by giving them tips and building their confidence, they become better, and then they can look at their audience around, they can smile and be confident, and it's beautiful to see. So you can definitely learn that. And to your point, the fear of speaking in public is bigger than the fear of death. That is so funny. But the good thing, as you said, is you can definitely learn it. And the other thing is as well, everybody is afraid at the beginning of a speech. Even the professionals, even the actors, before they're going to talk, they are all afraid, having these doubts, etc. And I'd like to mention one of my favorite quotes from Mark Twain, who said, actually, there are two types of speakers. The first are the nervous ones, the second are the liars.
Oh, that's great. Yeah. And for those people who still have this fear of public speaking, mm-hmm. Who have a lot to say, but mm-hmm. Are fearful to speak out, what would be your advice? How to overcome this fear?
Yes. So there are a few things that you can do. The first thing I would advise is preparation. Again, you need to prepare whatever you are going to speak about. So rehearse. Nowadays, we all have a phone. We can all record ourselves on video just to see how is our body language. If our voice is shaking when we talk, or if we are fluent in what we say, if we don't speak too fast or too slow. So I would really strongly suggest that people prepare and rehearse with their video so that, again, they can see what they can improve. Mm. Also rehearse for the time. If you are told you only have 10 minutes or 20 minutes to do your speech, you don't want to go on for half an hour because people will be bored, they will be annoyed that it's taking so long. So also make sure you are preparing for your time. So preparation is key, that's number one. The number two is as well, you can do some breathing exercise before going on stage, before doing your presentation. Take some deep breath, really like inhale for like 4 seconds, then block your respiration for 7 seconds, and then release for 8 seconds. So do that a few times, then you will see that your body starts to relax. And the third advice I would give is do some power poses. So do you know what a power poses are, Angela?
I guess so. Yes? And I also guess that now we are about to speak about body language, which is very important for leaders. So what are the power poses?
Exactly. So power pose is trying to take as much space as you can. So expand or stand like that, like Wonder Woman or Superman, you know? Just do that a few seconds before, again, you deliver your speech. Or if you don't have the opportunity to stand and do like that or expand, maybe just do that on your desk again, just to make sure that you're expanding, you're building your confidence. You may not do it consciously, but subconsciously, your body will pick up the signs and will help you calm down. So these are three things. There are many other things you can do, but these would be my first three tips that I would give. And again, to say to people, it is absolutely normal to have doubts, to be afraid, to be nervous before you talk. It's just trying to make sure that you control your emotions and you don't let your emotions control you.
Mm. These are great tips. These are really great tips. And it reminds me of the story which one of my clients told me about a doctor. She was a surgeon, and before any surgery, she would stand like this for 2 minutes and then go to the surgery.
Exactly. Oh, yeah, that's power pose. Yeah.
Yeah. And one of pre-performance rituals.
Exactly.
No?
Exactly.
Oh, good. Great. Thank you for sharing that. Leaders have very specific body behavior. Mm-hmm. What do you think, what would be the most typical body tells of leaders?
I would say confidence. And how do you see if someone is confident? Again, is having their shoulder back, so not just talking like that, but really like standing straight, shoulder back straight. Also, looking at people, not looking on the ground like that, what they're talking, really looking at people around them.
Eye contact,
exactly. And smiling as well. People, the confident leaders, even though when I'm thinking some people who talk on stage, sometimes they are focused, and I know, so sometimes I do it. I'm so focused on what I want to say that I'm serious, but smile as well. When you smile again, you are not only trying to relax yourself, but you also show that, yes, you're confident, you can handle everything. And if one day someone asks a question and you don't have the answer, that is okay. You can say, well, I don't have the answer right now, but I will look it up, or I need to find that out, because that's a great question, because nobody knows everything. So that would be my advice, yes. Mm.
You're sharing so valuable insights today with our audience. Thank you very, very much. And now my favorite part of our conversation, game of meanings. Uh-huh. You know, my background is in linguistics, mm-hmm. which is in other words called philology, philo for love and logos for word, mm-hmm. from Greek. And I do love meanings. I do love meanings. So I would now ask you to explain what you mean by these three words.
Okay.
And the words are authenticity, mm-hmm. integrity, mm-hmm. and confidence. Mm. So what is authenticity for you?
Authenticity, that's great. Authenticity is being who you say you are. So not pretending to be someone else, but really showing to your audience that you are who you say you are. So not faking it.
Mm. Not faking it. I like you have mentioned that, because they say fake it till you make it. Do you agree with that? Is it about authenticity?
That's a sentence I've also been struggling with. In a way, I understand why people say it, and it's about confidence. It means that if you're not confident, if you have all this doubt in yourself, don't show it, just fake it until you make it. So from that point of view, yes. And especially as a leader, if you have doubts and you show your teams you're afraid, your team will not follow you. So as a leader, you need to show you're confident. You need to show that, yes, we need to go for it. However, I would not suggest it, and by that meaning you should never lie. Mm. And there you should not fake it until you make it. What you can do, if they are, again, as a leader, you may get some confidential information and you still need your team to do certain things. Instead of lying to them and giving some fake excuse or whatever, the only thing you need to say to them is, listen, I've got some information, but I cannot share it with you for now. Mm. So what I would like to ask you is, we need to do this and that. This is for this reason. And as soon as I can share the information, I will share it with you. But for now, I just cannot. Mm. And people will respect you for that, because they will say, yes, this person has been honest. he or she has some information and he or she cannot share it, but yet he or she wants us to do this and that. And because this person is our leader, we need to trust him or her and we need to do what he's asked. Mm-hmm. And of course, the thing is to do after, and that comes to, I'm going to make the link with integrity, is once you've said something, you need to do what you said. Mm. And that is to me integrity. So authenticity is being who you say you are, and integrity is do what you say and say what you do, or say what you do and do what you say. So don't say one thing and then do the opposite. Or like as in my previous example, if I said, well, Angela, I've got some information, but I cannot release it now, but as soon as I have it, I will. And let's say we meet in a week, and in a week I can release the information. I should not pretend, I know nothing and I forgot about it, but maybe I will tell you, well, Angela, you remember what we discussed last week? Well, now I can share this information for you. So that then again, you will say, Virginie, she said that last week, she couldn't, but now she could. So that's how you build trust, because you said what you would do and you did what you said. So that is to me integrity.
Virginie, you mentioned the authenticity and keeping the word, and integrity and keeping the word. Sometimes people are lying or not keeping the word because they have taken too many obligations and put on too much on themselves. And how to say no? How to say no so that you don't sound like you're apologizing and you sound confident at the same time. So what's the best way of saying no? Because for leaders, it's important.
That's an excellent point, Angela. So again, back to what I was saying, you need to put yourself first, because as you say, if you take on too many things, then at some point you will not be able to do anything. So if you say no, you have to keep in mind that it doesn't mean never. It means no for now. Okay. Maybe it means yes tomorrow, or yes next week or next month. So again, set the right expectation. If you ask me to do something today and I cannot, I will say, Angela, I'm really sorry, I cannot help you today. However, next week on Monday, I can help you. Would that work for you? And often people appreciate that you say no now, but I didn't say no, never, I never want to do that. I gave you an alternative. And why it's very important is because if someone sees that you can say no, they will again trust you more, because they know that once you will be given a project and you've said no to them this time, the next time someone else comes and asks you to do something, you will be able to say no to that third person because you're working on their project. So they will know that you keep the right priority. Of course, there are always urgent things that happen and expecting things, and that is how you reprioritize things. But overall, you need to set the right expectations, say what you would do as you say, and learn to say no. And it's not easy. I know, I've also been there. I was that person in the past who was always trying to help people and say yes to everything. But you really need to learn, because in the end, as you said, you're going to take on too much, and then you're going to start to be stressed. And you're going to struggle either mentally or physically. You're going to maybe have headaches, backaches, whatever. And to my previous point, if you are not healthy, 100% mentally and physically, you will not be able to help your team. You will not be able to help your family. So always think, yes, it's okay to say no.
Do you remember the moment when you first said no?
It's actually when I was working in Italy. I had resigned, because just before going to Italy, I met my now husband. So that's the reason why I came back to the Netherlands. So I resigned in Italy earlier than I had myself planned. And my boss's boss tried to convince me to come back to work in the Netherlands for the same company. And I had to say no, because I had been working for this company for 12 years and I wanted to do something different. And he was a bit surprised that I said no first, because in the past, every time he was telling me, and he's the one, and I told him, he was the one who had told me, you should say no once in a while. So when I did it with him, he was a bit surprised, but I stick my ground. So that was one of the first things I remember when I said no, yes.
That's a very good example. Yeah. That's a very good example. Yes, sometimes we have to prioritize in life.
Yes.
Okay, and now we come to confidence. Confidence, and they also differentiate between confidence and self-confidence. Do you feel any difference, or is it just the same? Confidence, self-confidence.
I would say it depends. Again, I never had that question before. So confidence and self-confidence is the same in the sense that it is the faith you have in yourself. To me, that on that sense, it's the same. However, you can also give confidence and in that sense of trust to someone else. So then in that case, it's different. You have the self-confidence in yourself, in your abilities, in your skills, but you have also that confidence that you give to people that if you ask me to do something, you ask me because you are confident I can do the job. Yeah. You were kind to ask me, do you want to deliver a communication training within your school? So you were confident that I could do it, and I'm grateful for that. So in that case, to me, it's different. It's more related to trust. So you were trusting me that I could do it. However, you had confidence in me, and I was also confident. So I had self-confidence that I also could deliver that. Yeah. So it can be the same, but it also can be different.
Mm. And when we speak about leaders, confidence is a very important trait that they should possess. That's for sure, that 100% no doubts. However, could they, if they face failure, mm-hmm. what kind of behavior would you teach them to present when they feel like a little low and in the situation when they fail?
Yes.
So how to find the way out in such situations for a leader?
Yes. So the thing that people need to remember is that actually you never fail. You either win or you learn something. So that's the thing that they need to keep reminding them, that everybody fails sooner or later in their life. There is nobody who does everything perfectly and nobody who is doing everything well. Think of yourself as a little child when you were starting to walk. You first stood up and then you fell, and then you stood up again and then you fell, until you started to understand what it meant to really stand up and staying stand up. So you failed already when you were a little boy or little girl. So everybody is failing. The thing is to really learn the lessons from your failure. And as I said, there is no failure because you always learn something. So I also say, even if when a situation seems very negative or seems desperate, there is always a silver lining. If we take, for instance, the situation this year with the lockdown where we were stuck at home, for me, it was a bit challenging because, as you said, I'm a dancer. Salsa dancing is my passion, and that's where I was also releasing my stress. And now, obviously, I cannot go and dance anymore. So what did I could have said, oh, I can't dance anymore and feel bad and feel depressed. And of course, once in a while, I do miss dancing. However, what I did, I said, well, I still need to exercise. I cannot go dancing. I need to find something else. And what did I do? Well, I started to train in my living room. And every day since the 21st of March, actually, not every day, 5 to 6 weeks per day, I'm doing 30 minutes of gym in my living room.
Oh,
and so that helped me stay active. So in every situation, you need to find the positive. You need to find this silver lining, because again, sometimes we're so focused on what's happening to us. And I know some situations are very difficult. And usually when one bad thing happens, another one happens, and it looks like everything is happening at the same time. First, tell yourself it's okay to feel down, because also, even though I'm a positive person, I also have my ups and downs once in a while. But don't beat yourself up. Let it come. Let your emotion come. If you need to cry, if you need to sleep, do whatever you need to do just to let it come and let it go outside of your system. And once you've done that, and some people it may take 5 minutes, some people may need a day or a week or whatever, don't beat yourself up, accept it. Once you are over that period, now say, okay, what can I do now to start again? And try to have a goal and focus. This is how you will stay confident, that you will deal with failure. Again, as I said, I don't like that word, so I put it quote unquote. And this is how you will move forward. So that would be my advice.
Thank you for opening up your toolbox of how you overcome your negative things and failures in your life. Thank you very much. During these 6 months of 7 months of pandemic, what have you been has been the biggest lesson you have learned for yourself?
That you need to keep focused, you need to have a goal, and you need to stay positive. Mm-hmm. As we said, this period has been tough on all of us. Some people deal with it better than others, and even as I say, even positive people like myself, sometimes we have our downs as well. But when you have a goal, and it doesn't need to be a big goal, it can be a small goal, but
like have baby steps.
Exactly, have a goal in mind and keep being focused on that. And it's okay if one day you're not working towards it. As I say, if you want to take a whole day to watch Netflix movies, just do it if you need it. If you want to say, well, today I'm just going to go for a walk, or I'm going to go for the weekend somewhere just to relax and change. Change scenery, do it, but keep thinking of your goal and try to work towards it little by little. That way you will keep being motivated. And to me, that was probably the biggest lesson, is that the importance of having one or several goals, and that you need to keep focusing on it.
And my last question for today, it's kind of a game. What would you choose between these two, playing safe or playing to win, and why?
So it's a funny, because I'm usually not competitive, so I would say play it safe. However, I do know myself as well, I'm kind of ambitious, so if I'm going to do something, I'm going to try to win. So it's probably being a balance. But overall, if I really had to choose, I would probably say playing safe, because I would not want to win to say, hey, I'm the best, or you lost and I won. I'm not like that. So if I had to choose, I would play safe, but still in my mind, I would try to win as well. But yeah, if I have to choose, playing safe.
I think it's very consistent with who you are, a reliable person, a very professional person, and the person of a deep background in everything you do. And I'm so happy that we are partners at Lux Simburg School of Contemporary Etiquette. And I always know that I could rely on you, and I feel I have confidence in you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much, Virginie, for sharing your great insights today with the audience. And I hope you have received a lot of insights today, a lot of very important golden nuggets. Thank you once again for accepting my invitation and being my guest at Lux Etiquette and Service Cafe today, and hope to see you again.
Thank you for having me again, Angela. It was great. Thank you.
Thank you, Virginie.